welcome to the College of Complexes. My name's Don, and I'm going to be the moderator this evening. We got an echo, so it sounds like we're in a. It sounds like we're in the Allstate Arena.
In a space.
Anyway, no, we got a very special program tonight. Our speaker tonight is Dan Weinberg. Dan is going to be talking about can drugs help? Does Big Pharma tell the truth? Hey, you took away the echo.
Yes.
Hey, no fair.
You want the echo? I'll put the echo back up.
No, I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding.
We can definitely.
Yeah, we want to echo.
All right. Now, can drugs help? Does Big Pharma tell the truth? That's the subject tonight. Now, for those of you, I think most of you have been here before, but for those of you who have not been here before, we charge a tuition at our college of $3. If you haven't paid your tuition already, come see me. I'm also the treasurer in addition to being.
A round of applause for our speaker this evening,
Dan Weinberg.
Yay!
Okay, Dan, you can see it from here.
Thank you.
I got it here, so you can see it.
Oh, you got the over here?
You'll be able to see it and run the clicker from there.
Oh, where's the clicker?
Hey, Tim.
Good evening. I have a disclaimer first. I am not a doctor or a physician's assistant. But I am Schwooze the Clown and or Dr. Schwooze. Okay. So heroin could be effective in treating asthma, bronchitis, phytitis, which is tuberculosis, or and tuberculosis. Actually, heroin is used in England right now as a painkiller, but it's not called heroin. It's called something else. And of course, heroin in the United States is kind of illegal. The National Health Service in England is a national health service. It's national health. And in America, we don't have a national health service. And at the same time, in England, they're privatizing a lot of the national health service. So people are really getting bored and tired of the National Health Service there. And the National Health Service was started in 1948. Let me just show you some. I have bills right here, my personal bills for medical coverage. And it says here that they're paying out of $100, the company, the insurance company, is paying like $11. Now, what is going on? That's what I'm wondering. How can the medical place, the hospital that gave the test, how can they stay in business when the insurance is only paying 10%? That's a question I have. I don't know if they can stay in business. It seems like a lot of hospitals will be going out of business soon. This is a health magazine, July, August. And as you can see, there are large ads put in by pharmaceutical companies. Many ads are put in by pharmaceutical companies, and they spend $10,000 a page, and so they spend many thousands of dollars to tell people to buy drugs. I'm wondering how many people here have ever gone to their doctor and suggested something they saw on TV or read in a health magazine. Raise your hand if you ever suggested to your doctor that they give you something. Yeah, you did that?
Yeah, and I'm still taking it.
So you thought you were smart enough to look, see an ad, and tell your doctor.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe you are smart enough.
She
agreed with you?
Yes, she did, and it's been helpful.
Well, yay for the pharmaceutical companies.
One vote.
I mean, maybe the pharmaceutical companies should be making more money, because, you know, I think that might help them. They'll make even better drugs. I mean, if you look at the history of drugs, 100 years ago, people were dying of tuberculosis and different diseases. And now, how many people have heard of their neighbor getting tuberculosis? Raise your hand. See, nobody. So drugs do help. Medicine does help in some ways. Of course, the public health things with the sewer system, and so there are no more outhouses, that also helps. But drugs are helpful. Antibiotics. How many people here ever took an antibiotic? Okay, see? So that's a drug that helps. Okay. Steve Jobs said that those who are crazy enough to think they can change the world are the ones who do. And he was crazy. All right, so doctors. Doctors are not poor. The average income of doctors in this area is $268,000 a year. And they say that with national health, that might go down a little bit if a national health system goes into effect, but probably not very much. I showed the health magazine. Okay, so why isn't their national health system like in England, Canada, France, Germany, Mexico, Chile? Why isn't there? Who knows the answer?
Because this is American. We're different.
That's right. And yes.
The only way Obama could get through Congress, which is completely corrupt, is to benefit the insurance companies so that the insurance companies would be in favor of Obamacare, okay?
Okay. Yes?
You asked the reason why we don't have national health care?
Yes.
We have a for-profit system that makes enormous profits for billionaires who can say to the sick people, I'm sorry you're sick and dying because you can't afford the medicine. It's nothing personal, but we have to go for profits.
Right.
It's a profit-driven system where no profit is ever enough.
That's right.
And they buy and sell our politicians. That's why we don't have here.
Yeah.
Is that understandable?
Yes.
Absolutely.
And drugs are invented free, right?
No, drugs, in other countries, there are controls on drugs, actually. In Canada, for instance, they have a council called the Council to Control Drug Prices. And so people in America can go to Canada, even though it's against the law, you can still go on the internet and buy from a Canadian pharmacy. You can buy drugs from Canada if you need them. I mean, everybody knows that, of course. But getting back to why we don't have national health. Actually, the AMA was against national health, was against the American, was against national health. They were against Medicare. AMA was against Medicare. So I mean, and Medicare passed in 1965 for old people, and young people get CHIP, children health insurance program. And Medicaid for poor people, people on welfare and disabled. But the people in the middle, in between 65 and poor, most people don't get national health. So you got to move to Canada or England or Australia or France, Germany to get free medical care, or Israel or China. Anyways. So Ronald Reagan, the great Reagan, was of course against Medicare and against socialized medicine, because, right. And he called anything communist.
Right.
Right. And that's what the AMA, American Medical Association, called them socialists and communists. And actually I read about Medicare, and that wasn't so easy to get through in 1965, but it passed somehow. Okay, so we go to the rich get richer and the poor get poorer, the philosophy of anarchism. So healthcare in America is a commodity. It's something bought and sold, and the patient is a place to sell pills and service. So the new business model of America is healthcare, and there are many companies called health something, bill something something.
Health maintenance organization.
Health maintenance organization.
HMOs.
That's one thing. But they're also the billing. They're just health billing companies, and all they do is the billing, because it's so complicated now that doctors farm out their billing to companies that do billing, and that's a lot of billing. Okay. So, in America, 1 out of 6 uninsured mothers. There are 4.5 million uninsured children. 7.7 million uninsured young adults. 700,000 medical bankruptcies every year. People, about half of all bankruptcies are because of medicine, because of medical problems. So the USA system is private, not socialized medicine. Well, actually, of course, it isn't. Because if you think about Medicare and Medicaid and CHIP, it is partially socialized. So Medicare spending grew to $618 billion in 2014, which is a lot of money. And they're probably going to start cutting back even more, I would say. But I'm only 62, so when I'm 65, I hope that it's still there. So about 3 more years. 4 more years.
Three.
So prescription drug spending increased 12% in 2014 to almost $300 billion.
Yes.
Yikes. We didn't know.
It's a lot of money.
I got you.
So for the next 10 years, spending is supposed to grow at 5.8% per year. Myth number 12 is national health program would be more expensive. It really wouldn't be more expensive, but the insurance companies would have to agree to have a national health plan. And the drug companies like Pfizer and AstraZeneca would have to agree to be controlled. And of course they spend quite a lot of money giving money to bribes, I mean campaign donations to Congress and the Republicans and Democrats. So that would be a problem. The USA is not the best health system in the world. Of course, people come here for a lot of medical care, but more and more Americans are going to Thailand, Mexico, Canada for different procedures. India for knee replacements. We can't afford to cover everybody. It's not really true. We can. And everyone chooses his or her own doctor here. That's not quite true. When I had a doctor, when I had insurance, when I worked full time, I had my choice, sort of my choice as a doctor. He threw me out. After I got Obamacare, they said no more. They don't want Obamacare. It doesn't pay enough. As you can see on my bill, they pay 10% of a X-ray at Swedish Covenant Hospital. So I mean, they want to get rich. They want to drive their Cadillacs and take trips to Paris every year. And I don't blame them. But I think a national health plan might help that come along also. So, health as a percentage of gross domestic product. Of course, the U.S. spends the most, 15%. Switzerland, 11, almost 12%. France, Germany, down. And if the U.S. got national health, it might go down a little bit. But I want to talk about Social Security a little bit. When Social Security was put in 35, the Southerners, in order for the Southern senators and congressmen to agree to it, they said that domestic workers and farm workers would not get covered. And that was made law, basically because Hispanics did all the farm work and African Americans did the domestic work. Just a little sidelight. Sorry. Okay, next. Healthcare is excessively expensive, ineffective, and unjust. Somebody said that. Who said that? I don't know who said that. So doctors refuse to take HMOs or Medicare. I have a doctor now who refuses to take Medicare. I don't think he's proud of it. He has a lifestyle that demands that he gets reimbursed more than Medicare pays. Medicare doesn't pay very well. So doctors can decide to not take certain people. So they do. They do that. And doctors could still make $125,000 a year, and with Medicare, I think that would be good enough. It'd be good enough for me if I was a doctor. But I'm not a doctor.
It's not violence if they refuse, even, you know, that like middle thing, you know.
Thank you for that question.
It could be.
I mean, it could be a violation. It could be against the law to not take Medicare people. But of course, Congress did not pass that law. So yeah, it's legal. It's very legal to do that. It's called skimming the cream off the crop, and the poor people, they get SOL. They're SOL in this country, as some people say. I don't say it, some people. So what is socialized medicine? No, later. What? What's your question, ma'am?
Okay.
Miss? Hi, everybody.
Okay, so you know, I also would like to know, you know, like people who take care of another people, you know, like agencies, so. You know? So my question is, who, I mean, it's, they also buy Obamacare, you know, who take care of the let's say they're hiring like part time.
Maybe it's insurance, maybe it's Medicare, maybe Medicaid. I don't know.
But this agency not refused to pay them if they, you know.
On Medicare? Yeah. I don't know. Well, like nursing homes. Nursing homes take Medicare, they make Medicaid. They'll take any kind of money. Maybe ones, nice ones in Northbrook, they don't take Medicare or Medicaid. But ones in Chicago, they take Medicare and Medicaid.
Right.
And socialized medicine, there is socialized medicine right now. Medicare, the VA health system, all veterans get care for their life, for their, as long as they live. And that's, you know, whether they're black, white, whether they're in Vietnam or Iraq, whether they're 80 years old or 20 years old, all veterans get free medical for the rest of their life. And Medicaid is socialized medicine too. So rule number one, which is from this book. This is a book I read, one of the first books I read about this. Andy, you don't know about this book.
What is it?
The Truth About the Drug Companies by Marcia Angel, yeah. Two L's.
I have that.
You have that? All right. It's about 10, 11 years old. Yeah. She's a doctor. She was the editor of the New England Journal of Medicine. And she wrote this book about the truth about drug companies, how they make so much money. And there's a lot of good stuff in it. If you want more information, you can always read that book. How am I in time, Tim?
Fine.
Sorry. It's 7:07. You know, I got.
Yeah, you're only gone for like 15, 20 minutes.
Okay. Is that all?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's all.
Okay. So places to go for socialized medicine. You can go to India, Canada. Let me go back there. India, Canada, Mexico, what I said before. I have a family member who goes to Mexico for his dental. Dental is maybe 25, 50% off of America. Of course, they only take cash, I think. Maybe they take insurance. I'm not really sure.
Can they do it on the street or what?
No, this was Charlie. I'm glad you asked. This was the head of the Juarez Medical Society, Dental Society. He did fine work. Root canals. You know, root canal is very expensive in America. Okay. So, rule number two, you should ask your senators and congressmen in Congress, do you receive donations from pharma, and if so, how much? There's actually, you can Google this on the internet. You can find out how much, like, Senator Durbin or Senator Kirk made from the Pfizer and AstraZeneca and the other companies. You can find out exactly how many dollars they got every year. What? Complicated? No, it's very simple. Just use your internet. And also, you can also get doctors. Every doctor who's taken money from pharma, from Pfizer, AstraZeneca, Glaxo, SmithKline, whatever. You can Google, there's a website that you can put in your doctor's name and get exactly how much they got. Well, this is actually how much they reported. I'm not sure if they tell the truth. You know, maybe they got a new house in Florida that they didn't put, that they didn't report. Or they got a new Cadillac car or a new BMW or something like that. But actually, I put in my doctor, and it said that he got an $8 meal from Pfizer in last year. And he reported that. And he got a $13 meal in 2013 and a $17 meal in 2012. So I think the doctors are, of course, they're influenced by these meals and by these trips that they get free from Pfizer and GlaxoSmithKline. All right, rule number three. When your doctor prescribes a new drug, ask him these questions. Oh yeah, okay. Well, I'll ask the question. The questions are like, did you get money from Pfizer? Did you go out to dinner with Pfizer? Did you get a meal? Did you get a trip to Hawaii? And if he lies, and you know, he might lie, but he might tell you the truth also. And you can judge a person by how much money they take from the drug companies. No?
They won't answer that.
They won't? No?
But they might
throw you out of his office.
Well, you got to find a doctor who will talk to you, I think.
Maybe that guy in Mexico.
Maybe.
No, I'm not going to Mexico.
You go to India, Charlie? Canada?
Yeah, but you have to.
But you have insurance.
Guys,
you're a lucky person.
Yeah, one pool at a time, y'all.
All right, so that's the questions. So, news. I saw in the news Obama's $1 trillion nuclear weapons update.
Uh-oh.
So, instead of spending money on health care and education, he's updating the nuclear weapons, nuclear bombs. We need more nuclear bombs, newer ones, better ones. So I don't know. So he'll have to propose spending cuts for all the programs like Social Security, health care, housing, etc., to pay for the bombs. So, Cheap medicine. This is a good website. Actually, I use it myself. GoodRx.com. Actually, Pharma sponsors it, so it's a very fancy website. The latest gizmos on it. Anyways, if you go to GoodRx.com and you take a breathing pill or high blood pressure or diabetes, if you have that. A lot of people here don't. You look pretty healthy. But anyways, if you do have that kind of medicine need, go to goodrx.com and you can get good coupons. Actually, they really do. Because I got a coupon for a free year of, what's it called? Arnuity. It's breathing. I smoked 20 years, so I take this annuity stuff. And actually, it works quite good, and I'm supposed to take it every day, which is crazy. It's like $50 a month, and so I'm not going to take it because I can't afford it. I got bills to pay, so I got a free year. Free year, whole year, a month's supply, 12 months, free. And of course, at the end of the 12 months, they expect me to keep buying it if I'm still alive. And actually, this is the warning inside our annuity. Now, I don't know if you can see this. I know you can't see this up here. You can't read it. But it has a lot of blah, blah. It's about... Well, it's about what's in it, and drug interactions, and pharmacology, and also a lot of warnings, warning you about, you know, drug interactions. Don't take it if you're on Varga Hargit, you know, like, just don't take it.
Right.
You might die if you take this. I mean, look at this.
Yeah.
They expect people to sit down and read this shit?
No, they don't.
Are they fucking nuts?
No, they don't expect.
Are they crazy?
No, it's
they're not. I guess the lawyers all made them write this stuff, you know.
That's to cover their backside.
Yeah. So, you know, and it's really ridiculous. I mean, you see ads on TV that have warnings, you know, and at the end it says you might die from this.
Right.
And, well, actually, you know, they say medicine, take your medicine. It's dangerous stuff. You know, on one hand, like medicine for tuberculosis, you get a vaccine for tuberculosis, you get a little bit of tuberculosis in your arm. So that's called medicine. But of course, it's better just to be healthy and not take any pills and not smoke, not drink, be a good person, devoted life, and you'll be fine and healthy. That's what I plan to be in my life. After I smoked for 20 years. But this is quite something. I think it's really unique, and I don't know if everybody, has anybody ever read one of these whole things? You have?
Yes.
I tried. Okay, 2%, or maybe 5% of the people have read it.
I read that.
Okay. Mazel tov. But, I mean, you know, you gotta work on your health. You take care of your health and everything. All right. So GoodRx is a very good place.
What does that do? Good health? GoodRx, what does that do?
They have coupons from Pharma, from the drug companies on there. And you can print them out and bring them to your druggist and they'll be cheaper. They have a lot of things. They have where to go, like Walmart and CVS and Walgreens, and they have those kinds of coupons also.
It's not cheap medicine.
Okay.
Got that? They say cheap medicine in Walmart.
All right. GoodRx.
That's right.
Great website. So the Affordable Care Act or single payer? Well, the Affordable Care Act is, of course, written by the drug companies and by the insurance companies, so it's not the greatest thing on earth. But it's a little bit better than it was before. They now have
pre-existing conditions.
Pre-existing conditions, right. So the cost of medicines are going up every year, co-pays and deductibles. And I'll say something about the book. There are things called patents. Drugs get patented. Like what's a blood pressure, high blood pressure drug? No, like an older one.
Low pressure?
No. No, the name of the drug I want.
Lisinopril.
Hydroxyurea. Well, anyways, they have one low blood pressure medicine, and that patents are good for 20 years. And then when the patent is running out, they switch you to a new drug medicine, which is a lot more expensive. And this is typical of the pharma, and it happens a lot. Cost of meds. There's hidden costs of marketing, promotion, sales, public relations. All those ads I showed you from the magazine, there's a lot more put into promotion than into research. They say all the money, the high cost that goes into research. If you look at a chart, here's research and here's promotion. It's a lot more promotion and sales and marketing. Thing goes into research. I don't know how necessary that is, and with a single payer national health, I think it would be different. So donations to Congress. Pharma paid only $21,600,000 in 2014 to your senators and congressmen. And, you know, so if you send $100 and say, please get a single payer, I'm not sure if they'll listen to you. But you can try. And, okay. Hospitals and nursing homes, $14,700,000. Pfizer donated $19 million in 2013. And the website is opensecrets.org. It's a good website. They have all the money that's given to Congress.
What will they get out of that?
Well, they'll get the Affordable Care Act. Okay. And they get, I know what they get. That's a good question. Medicare, it's written into the law that they cannot negotiate for drug prices.
Right.
Well, that's what that bought. That's what the $19 million bought. It bought the law that says the government cannot negotiate. I mean, the Veterans Association, Veterans Administration, they can negotiate for drug prices, but Medicare cannot. So, you know, go to Canada. That's what I say. All right. So, what?
That's deductible.
It's deductible.
To go to Canada?
No, that 19 million.
Yeah. Well, research is all tax deductible, and research is done by universities. I don't think it is tax deductible for the corporation. I don't know. You'd have to ask them. All right, that's about all. So all I'm saying is drugs are terribly expensive, and a single payer insurance, national insurance for everybody would be really, really good. Thank you very much.
All right. Dan, you're not off the hook yet. Okay. We gotta give you a little grilling now. So we're gonna move into the question and answer session, y'all. And so who has a question, just raise your hands and I will call on you. Just remember all questions must end with question. Mark? Tim has his hand up, so Tim gets the first question.
A few years ago I had a pet and it was a cat and I used to take it to the vet quite often. All of a sudden, a little product called pet health insurance came in, and all of a sudden, when I would go to a veterinarian, over a six-year period, prices almost tripled because of the introduction of pet health insurance. Isn't there some kind of correlation between the veterinarian aspect of pet health insurance and perhaps maybe what it costs to treat human beings with health insurance?
I think, yes, that's very possible. I'd say that the insurance companies were looking for another way to make money. So somebody had a bright idea of let's insure pets. And so, I mean, the Affordable Care Act is cutting down on some of their profits, so they have to look for profits elsewhere.
Yeah, the nation both.
Okay, who
yes.
else? All right, does anybody else? Yes, Wes.
What about Obamacare? What's your opinion on that?
I think the insurance companies wrote it, pretty much, so it's good in some ways. In some ways, the pre-existing conditions are covered. More kids, more poor people are on it. But it's not the greatest. It could be a lot better with single payer.
Yeah, sure.
I think.
Yeah, I just want to make a point of clarification. Dan, you already talked about the Affordable Care Act. The Affordable Care Act is the same thing as Obamacare. Obamacare is a smear term used by Republicans to, for the Affordable Care Act because they wanted to make it sound bad by associating with the president. Okay, does anybody else have a question? Yes, Pat.
Yeah, you touched on earlier, and I'm sorry I got to class late, so I may have missed part of this. The fact that one of the options, of course, is to go to Mexico, Canada, or India.
Right.
There is no question about the quality of care and the quality of the drugs used in Canada. But I've heard stories that in other countries, such as India, such as Mexico, the quality of the drugs and indeed even the quality of the training physicians receive over there is not up to Western standards, which means you take your chances.
Right.
Is this true?
I think you have a point, but I think also if you do your research and pay your money, I mean, it's like anything else. If you pay, you play. So even in India, Mexico, and Canada, you still have to come with some cash. Yeah. It's not free. And yes, there is a risk. But a lot of those Indian and Canadian and Mexican people are trained in America. Then they go back to their countries. So try to find one of those people, I would say.
All right. Charlie, did you have a question?
Yeah, Dan, we've listened to you. For an hour, you've been putting down the pharmaceutical industry, but I don't hear any alternatives to it. Maybe before there was a pharmaceutical industry, you had to go see an old lady someplace in your village who might give you some weeds she pulled out of her backyard. Is this what you're recommending we go back to doing, or what?
Charlie. I want you to read this book. Can you read this book?
I don't have time to read. I'm reading my medicinal chart that came with my drugs.
Well, this is by a doctor who says that the pharmaceutical companies make way too much money, and they use patents not nefariously. Nefariously, they use them nefariously, and they also.
Where do I go to drugs if I don't go to them?
I understand.
Either I go to them or I don't have drugs, or I go to
I understand.
The
well, like I said, 100 years ago, people were dying of polio and tuberculosis and of simple infections.
And they don't, so the system works.
To a certain extent, it does.
Are they dying or not?
No.
That's working.
All right.
It can be better.
Yeah.
It can be better.
Oh, okay. Better than not dying.
All right. Dave?
I hear so much about the single payer. They are payers.
Yes.
Could you explain that? I don't.
Yeah. Well, yeah, sure. I mean, that would take a whole talk, 40 minutes. But I'll do a short version. Look at Canada. Look at Germany. Look at France. Look at England, Israel. Portugal,
Cuba.
What do they have?
They have a national health plan, and they do it, and it works pretty good. And the people in England have a national health plan, and it works pretty good.
All right. Look, I don't feel. Look, if I may ask a follow-up question to Dave Singers, I don't. I, based on what you have said about all these other countries of the world, look, I don't know anything about their healthcare system. When you say England, I don't know what that means. I don't know anything
then
about English healthcare.
Then
how is it different
then
from U.S. healthcare?
All right, I'll tell us.
Then go on Google.
Just name a country.
They're all national health.
That's
that means
right.
That there's one single payer, that there's one.
Who pays?
Government.
So the government pays for everybody's health care.
Yeah. Yeah, it's like the government.
Even the rich.
No, the rich can go anywhere they want because they have money and they can take a plane
trip. It's some arrangement,
to,
you know.
Okay, let's just one pool at a time.
One pool at a time.
Yeah, okay, go
so
ahead.
So the rich can go to Boston or New York City and take
sure.
Or Chicago,
they choose to.
They could go to Northwestern.
But if they stayed in England, they could get the health care too, same as everybody else.
Yes.
So everybody's on the same system.
Everybody.
It's all paid for by the
government.
It was just like, it would be like if everybody in the United States got Medicaid.
That's right, or Medicare. That's right.
Okay. Thank you. All right. Yes, Ilana, you did have your hand up.
Yeah. Okay.
No, I'll get to you in a moment, sir.
Okay,
go ahead. She had her hand up.
Okay, very quick. Not that similar.
I know.
Okay, Charles, I have for you a question. You try to praise pharmaceutical company or...
Ilana, just go ahead and ask your question, okay?
Okay, my question is, are you sometimes pay copay? If you're going for medicine to Walgreens, you stay in the line and they're asking you, they're begging you to put like, okay, pick up like from your pocket $1, $2,
okay, what's your question, Ilana?
I go to the drugstore. I have insurance.
My question is that people pay copay anyway. So what is good about it?
Pretty good.
All right.
Ask a question.
All right. Did you have a question?
Yes, he answered it.
Okay. All right. There's a lot of hands up. Go ahead.
Yeah, it seems like a lot of politicians who are against making prescription drugs more affordable along the lines of prices. Let's say, for example, one country that's not too hard to know about because they're right next to us, Canada. So would you agree that a lot of these public officials who are trying to not provide the most affordable prescription drugs are also, coincidentally, the same ones that are always trying to also roll back FDR's New Deal?
Yes.
That was my question.
Okay. All right. Who else? Andy, you had a question.
Andy, you can't get it. It's your turn.
Yeah, he's busy.
Okay.
Got it. In all your research, did you run across the difference between the concept of we have billionaires in the middle. We pay a bunch of money to billionaires, and some of it filters on down to the doctors. Isn't that different from the national health care, where they don't have billionaires in the middle making enormous profits off of sick people?
Yes.
Can you elaborate on that just a little bit?
A little bit. I think the billionaires are the government in, like, England and Canada, France, Germany.
The U.S.
No. They're billionaires. Well, I mean, yeah, right. They're the billionaires are in America. But that's okay, because the government's okay. Right?
Yeah, I'm right.
Yay.
Okay.
Get a point, yeah.
All right, who else? Ma'am.
My name is Felicia, and I'm a friend of Ilana's and Daniel.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. This is maybe my second or third time here. And this is a question to everyone that's here. There was an investigative movie done a few years ago by Michael Moore, who's done a lot of very interesting films. This one in particular is called Sicko,
right.
And I'm wondering how many people here have seen it and remember the gist of it. Just a couple. It's a wonderful but very disturbing comparison between the healthcare system in the United States and other countries, and particularly France, England, Cuba, how they do things there. And how they
right.
do things here.
Excuse me, ma'am. This would make an excellent rebuttal speech, but it's not really a question
no,
at all.
No, it was a question
well,
to
no,
the audience.
Excuse me, ma'am. This is a time for questions directed at him. And so I'm going to have to move on to someone else who has a question. Who else has a question?
How about the speaker? Have you seen the movie? And what do you think of it?
Sicko?
Yeah.
I saw some of it, I think. It was okay. It was a good movie, yeah.
Okay. Now, is there anybody else who has a question who has not already asked a question? Okay, well, if there isn't, we'll go into a second round of questions because Charlie had his hand up.
Oh, me?
Yeah, Charlie.
I don't see why the healing arts, medical community should be separated from the rest of the capitalist part of the economy.
What, thank you, sweetheart.
We don't nationalize any other industry.
Well, why did we nationalize Medicare? Why is there Medicare?
What?
Why is Medicare there? I have a question for you.
You don't answer a question with a question.
Well, I do that. Well, anyways.
What kind of speaker is this? He's asking me questions. Give me the free dinner.
Well,
I've got to answer the question.
All right,
I've got to both ask the question and answer it. What kind of system is this?
Okay. Sorry.
Hey, you look like Richard Nixon that way.
Answer it.
Why?
All right. So, capitalism, right. But there's capitalism, there's Medicare, Medicaid. Also, there's all kinds of controls on prices. Just name the product and there's a control on prices.
You were belly aching at the beginning, then it was private.
All right. Did you want to say anything to Dan? Okay,
no.
Let's go on. Sir, did you have a question?
Yeah, you raised a question about the doctors making $200,000 a year.
Right.
What's wrong with that? These doctors deserve it. If anybody deserves to make kind of money, doctors deserve it.
I said that that's okay. And in national health, if we had a national health care, things might go down a little bit, but not very much. I think doctors and surgeons do very...
They deserve it.
Right, they do very important work, right. But I think people deserve to live also.
$250,000 of medical school and then the health insurance.
All right, hey, Tim, one fool at a time. All right. Now, does anybody else have a question? Anybody? All right. If there are no further questions, then let's have a big hand for our speaker, Dan Weinberg. You can sit down now. Okay. All right. What's this gadget here? Oh, this is to control the slideshow, isn't it?
Yes, it was.
Okay. All right. Now it is. It is time for the rebuttal period.
You want to disconnect?
And we ended nobody had any other questions. We ended a little bit early. Dean, is your hand up because you want to give the first rebuttal speech?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Good. Well, let's have a show of hands. How many, you can go ahead and sit in the on-deck chair, I'll count you, but let's have a show of hands, everybody. How many people want to give a rebuttal speech? Everybody who wants to give a rebuttal speech, raise your hand. Okay, that's one, two, three, four, I saw a hand back there, five, and you two? You want to give a rebuttal
speech? Oh yes, I forgot to hold my hand.
Oh yeah, six. Okay, very, very good, sir. And so it's, okay, so we got six. Six rebuttal speakers. Now, so what do you say? 20 minutes each, Tim?
I would probably say six.
6 minutes?
Yeah, I'll.
I'm just joking about 20 minutes each, guys.
If you want to go to seven, we can go to seven.
Let's keep it down to five, and
with a little leeway.
Yeah, because in case some other people decide they want to speak, then we won't run over time, and nobody will be cut short. So let's just keep it at the usual maximum of 5 minutes each, and just to be on the safe side. And Gene, you're for number one.
Yeah, boy, Gene.
Okay, thanks a lot, Dan. It was a very interesting talk. I'll start off by saying that I take some medicine myself. I take Losartan for blood pressure and simvastatin. To knock my cholesterol down. I also take eye drops, two kinds, which I can't name, for glaucoma. So I do take a lot of medicine. I pay very little for it, unlike a lot of other people. I want to talk about briefly a community care program. There are a lot of people in Illinois who need care in their own home. It's called the community care program. for seniors and people with disabilities. They may call it a different thing for people with disabilities, but I think there are 43,000 people who get care in their own home, usually up to about 20 hours, and that saves us taxpayers a lot of money because that keeps them out of a nursing home. It costs five times as much to put somebody in a nursing home as to care for them in their own home. So that's a good program, and a lot of it is covered by Medicaid. The single payer program is pretty much like Medicare program, and I think it might have been smarter for President Obama if that was his intent to cut costs by just making Medicare eligible for more people. You could have knocked the age from starting at 65 down to 62, and then down from there, and eventually you would have gotten to the same as single payer if you did that the slow way rather than the way they did it. I admit that Obamacare is a lousy form. Yeah. However, I personally know of three of my relatives and friends who live in Kentucky who had nothing before Medicare, before Obamacare, and now they have good care. Yeah. I also have a friend, I actually ate breakfast with her this morning, and she has four kids who are middle-aged. Three of them are on Obamacare, and all of them are college graduates. All of them, the three out of the four are unemployed, and they all get Obamacare. So in spite of the fact that I don't like the program, I have to admit it does help a lot of people. One thing I missed is there is a DVD admitting it's like a decade old, 10 or 12 years old. It's called Sick Around the World. It's put out by PBS. Who else would put this out? And it explains a lot of the other types of medical programs that Dan was talking about, including Canada, England, Japan, Switzerland. It was interesting in Switzerland, they asked the president of Switzerland, they said, does anybody in Switzerland go bankrupt because of medical costs? He said, no, that would be an embarrassment. He actually came out against the program, but when it came in, of course, he's now favoring it. But that's interesting that nobody, according to this film, nobody in Switzerland goes bankrupt because of medical expenses. I wonder how many go bankrupt in the United States because of medical expenses. Thank you.
Thank you.
You're not forced to stay here. You can leave anytime you want.
Okay.
How much time?
We'll go 5 minutes with a generous, if you need to go longer, go ahead.
Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. once said, of all the forms of inequality, injustice in healthcare is the most shocking and the most inhumane. And it's with that quote that I say my thoughts on tonight's speaker's excellent presentation. They've been trying for a long time to roll back FDR's New Deal, because the New Deal is kind of the light that shines on what's ahead if we continue to have more we the people power in our policies, democracy and not oligarchy, which is what we currently are. Jimmy Carter was in an interview the last couple of years ago with a European interviewer, and he said in response to a question about Edward Snowden that basically we don't live in a functioning democracy right now. We live in, he didn't say this, but I'll go ahead and interpret what I got out of it. We live in a failed state, at least on one issue. I feel single-payer health care is not in the world's wealthiest country the way to see our responsibility to those
who happen to have an injury or happen to be a senior citizen or a person with disability or just a person who has fatigue because they worked that hard their entire lives and made America what it is. My mom was a nurse for 33 years. She had multiple sclerosis for 18 in those years, and she still has to pay co-pays when she goes to the doctor. Square that circle, Springfield. Square that circle, D.C. Square that circle, Wall Street, K Street. Explain that to we the people when they can have two simultaneous billion or trillion dollar wars, bailouts for Wall Street, subsidies for the fossil fuel industry, subsidies for the surveillance military, the surveillance industrial complex to take from what Eisenhower described as our bloated military budget. I've lived a very privileged, pampered, sheltered, spoiled life. I can say that. I lived in Europe 30 years ago because my dad was a physicist and we happened to have the opportunity to go to Europe and live there for three years.
Where?
And I'll tell you after. That's not the main point, but I will talk to you in detail about it afterwards. So we had universal health care 30 years ago, and it worked. And one of the reasons why they had universal health care in Northern Europe, where my dad was fortunate enough to get a job, and me and my mom and my brother and I were fortunate to not have to worry about health care if an emergency happened, or at the time when my mom had multiple sclerosis, is because they have more powerful unions. Now, do you remember in the 80s how much Reagan got away with demonizing unions? Do you remember that?
Yes.
We do, because it was shocking on the other side of the Atlantic to hear how much he hated the New Deal. Right. It's one of the most popular legislations in the history of the United States of America. They have living wages there as a result of their terrible unions, as the Reaganites will call them. They have a higher percentage of their population having a living wage because of those terrible unions that Reaganites always love to talk about. Paul Ryan. Think Paul Ryan whenever you see him in a Fox News interview, in rare form, going off on how it's so terrible that the democracy, which we don't even have, so that's the big scam. They lay that out, that we're in a democracy, but we aren't. The democracy doesn't need to be extended to the industrial sphere. It can be on election day that you have the democracy to vote for two different choices. Sure. Sure, you can have two different choices to pick two different reactionary imperialists on election day. But do you have democracy when you get sick or your 72-year-old mom needs to go to the doctor because she had a stroke? No, Paul Ryan, wherever his brilliant mind is right now, and the rest of them. In Europe, they have unions because they remember World War II. People were dying because there was a war. You don't have to look in a history book in Europe. You just go down the street and you ask somebody, what was it like to live through World War II? And there's somebody's grandmother or grandfather or great-grandfather or great-grandmother could tell you that you don't let people die on the street when they're sick, because that's way they came back to their civility and their dignity and their humanity after that horrific event where we all got together to defeat fascism. All of us, Europeans, Russians, Americans, the world said no to fascism. So, you know, it's a minor thing that we have such sugar and sodium and caffeine and cholesterol laden items on our shelves at the grocery store. It's much more important that we need a democracy in this country. We need an actual, real, we the people awakening moment where we say no to oligarchy. And we can do that. We love our block parties and our family reunions and our picnics and our barbecues. Peacefully and democratically, we can mass mobilize for a general strike. And that's what anyone who's thought about this issue would, I think, join with us in calling time for. Thank you to the speaker today.
Okay. I'll, don't worry about the time, Tim. You mind the camera. I'll keep time.
Very good. Very good.
Here you go.
Everything for everybody.
My name is Raj Patel. I've been very fortunate in doctors. My current doctor is with me for 15 years. He's been very good. Doctor before was very good. I talk with him. We argue about what medication or what taste or what procedure. And sometimes I say, why do I need that taste? And I don't, you know, what are you going to do after I get the results? And sometimes I don't take the test. But we work together. Sometimes I cannot wake up in the morning at 3 o'clock.
and cannot sleep. I do not think about moralizing or who's fault or who's corrupt and who is bad. I don't think like that. Because we all try to do best we can. We all want more money. We want all want better life. And apparently doctors and lawyers and lawmakers, everybody's going to do that. The important issue about drugs. Our government has failed, and particularly the patent department, because they are not doing enough job. And the second thing they are not doing enough job is that the public, people do not have support of the people. Most of the people are white, and they are covered pretty well. Okay, no, except probably bottom 20%. Most people are covered. They are happy with their health care, their insurance, their everything, unless they get in a big ditch like a cancer or something. And that's a reality. And that leads to not enough support for agencies. Now, let me give you an example. One thing he mentioned about is that tricking the drugs. Drugs are about to expire, they put some inexpensive drug in that and make a new pattern. And again, 20 years. Drug patterns should not be 20 years, they should be 7 years. They were 7 years, Congress changed 2 years back to 20 years. And that is a big problem on drug cost. Recently, court in India refused to issue a patent to a big company. And do you know what happened? They went generic, but they had no choice. And thus, most of the Asia and the Middle East and Africa, they saved lots of money. Okay, because drug which they would have charged 10 times, 20 times more, now it's generic, so they don't charge so much. And still drug company makes money. It's not drug company losing money. They went generic because still they have their license and they make money on those licenses. Okay, one of the things, European things and our thing. In Europe, they spend lots of money on social care, and we don't. When you add social care and the healthcare cost, it's about similar. And they are not, and this is a myth that socialized medicine helps everybody nicely. It doesn't. I know, I have relatives in Canada, I have relatives in England, you know, and sometimes they have a long wait for important surgery in England. Okay, and in Canada, you can get certain service, sometimes you need a service, you cannot get it. And so I mean, we are not doing that bad. I wish we can control cost better and on the drugs. And drugs, we spend $400 billion a year for drugs. And a $17 trillion economy. God, that's not too bad. Imagine my father had diabetes. He used to pain so much. Okay, he cannot bear the pain in his legs, and there was no medication. Now, there are 40 million people with diabetes, and they are living a healthy life. Okay, that's a lot of change. 40 million people living healthy life, and we are expecting a lot more people will have diabetes. Okay, so let us say what we have. And then what we can improve upon.
You don't want to pay tuition. Okay.
And every single issue.
Okay. Do you don't want to pay tuition?
Don't moralize it. It's not a moral thing.
You don't want to pay. Maybe you feel
we are not that much moral human being. We are selfish human beings. Okay. American system is not designed to be a moral thing. And the second thing, let me tell you about democracy. Democracy is not a dictatorship. You can appeal to a king, and king say, this will be the law. It doesn't work like that. It's not going to work like that. You have to go and fight and convince everybody. And this is not going to be easy. And it hasn't been easy. Obama, several years back, in this forum, I presented a plan for a national health care.
What do you want? Get you?
And I go back and I think it's still a better plan. Because it was talking about that people pay something for their plan. Okay, and they have option to pay certain day. They don't pay. They don't take a medicine. And when they have to go to the hospital, then they have to pay more.
Okay.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
Okay. Thanks.
Sorry.
Yay. You guys done everything for everybody, right?
Oh,
yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
Okay, we got an empty podium here.
Did you use your mic?
All right. All right, who else wants to give a rebuttal speech? Anybody? All right, Andy, come on down. Oh, Pat. Oh, okay, Pat.
What do they have in Ireland? What do they have in Ireland?
You know, we keep hearing about big pharma, big business, the big kingmakers in Washington. But you know, for all of the talk about how democracy in this country is a past tense piece of our history, I'd ask everyone here, when was the last time you voted in a primary election? When was the last time you had the good sense when you go to vote to realize that none of these guys are perfect, none of them are saints? We have to choose between the lesser sometimes of two or three or four evils.
Right.
And you know, to say, oh, I don't vote, it only encourages them. Sounds like a cute little saying, but the fact of the matter is, if we are losing our democracy in this country, and there's evidence that we are, if we are becoming an oligarchy, and there's evidence that we are, it's because of the fact that too many people sit on their fat duffs during election day saying, especially primary elections, and they say, oh, well, what good is it going to do? I'm just going to sit back and play tiddlywinks or what have you. 250 years ago, a member of the British Parliament said, all that is necessary for the triumph of evil is that good men do nothing. I would suggest that before we start pointing the fingers at Big Pharma, and they're certainly worthy of our scrutiny, and before we point the fingers at corruption in Washington and congressmen who take bribes, contributions,
right,
from each and every special interest group. How many here are members of watchdog groups? How many here are watching their own congressmen, looking at their voting records? There you go. Now, many of you who've been to Washington know that being a congressman is probably one of the nicest jobs in the world. Yes, if you do it right, you work your buns off. But the fact of the matter is, you have, if you use it intelligently, an incredible amount of power, and at the same time, you have an incredible amount of temptation because people are trying to buy you left and right. On the other hand, they pay you pretty well, too. And I think that anybody who cannot live on, I believe right now it's $225,000 a year, including all the benefits, anyone who cannot live on that, you know, doesn't need a raise. He needs a financial counselor. No, really. How much money can you spend, you know, in the space of a year? How much money should you spend in the face of a year? How much money should a country spend in the face of a year? Which gets me to another part of this evening's discussion, and that is healthcare. About 10 years ago, when Rahm Emanuel was running for Congress, I was spending a day or two covering him, shadowing him, if you will. And with me was, incredibly enough, General Shalakavili, who at that time was retiring as the Army Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. We went to lunch, and Emanuel said to the two of us, you know, we could have a very good health care system if we simply expanded the Medicare program, took out some of the kinks, and applied that to the entire American citizenry.
Wow.
And you know, the fact of the matter is that it'd be a hell of a lot better than what we've got right now. I'm not saying Obamacare should be scrapped.
It's a better system than what we had before, which was none. But I am saying that there's always room for improvement. And there are doctors who will tell you the same thing. A friend of mine, who used to come here to the College of Complexes with me on occasion, was an MD psychiatrist. And she was constantly frustrated because you would think as a psychiatrist you'd be in a position to do an incredible... my time is almost out. We'll discuss this some other time. Thanks very much.
Okay. Good job, Pat.
Thank you.
The USA is so bad, you don't.
Well, we're not the ones wearing the hammer and sickle at our
head. Whoa, sorry. Okay, you ready? You ready, Andy?
Yeah.
Okay.
For those of you that missed the introduction, my name is Andy Anderson. I'm from the Northwestern Relations Service in Palatine. And we summarize books. I brought some books tonight that summarize some of the things that were talked about by our speaker. First off, I would like to say I've given talks here a couple times a year since 2007. And I've talked about censored news. Censored news in America, the premier censored news journalism project is out of Sonoma State in California. They publish this book every year called Project Censored News. 25 news stories that didn't make the news and why. There's certain things you can't... Certain things you can't talk about in America, or they will shut the mic off, go to the red button, cut the mic off, and go to commercial, and you never see it on television. The clearest example of that kind of censorship, trying to shut the mic off or shut a speaker down, was seen here at the start of this program tonight. We have a sign up here that says College of Complexes. You know, this is supposedly a free speech forum. I tried to give an announcement of a couple of minutes at the start of this program tonight, and as soon as the moderator saw what subject I was going to introduce into the record, he tried to shut me down and move me off the mic. So now I'm going to talk about that during the rebuttal. The information, as it directly relates to the pharmaceutical industry and what they've been doing in this country in the last 50 years, right? This book, a specific company called Burroughs Wellcome, the pharmaceutical industry, they're now GlaxoSmithKline, they developed a drug called AZT back in the 60s. It was a cancer chemotherapy drug for cancer. It was proven to be untreatable for cancer because it stopped the growing cells all over the body. It was toxic and poisonous in almost any low dose. It was a stone-cold killer. It sat around for over 20 years on the chemist shelves with no patent ever been filed because they knew if you took it for more than a few weeks, it would stop all the growing cells in your body and kill you. In 1985, Burroughs Wellcome helped bribe the people on the FDA that did not resign. Some doctors resigned because they said, we're not going to be part of approving that drug. That's going to be like rat poison for humans. Burroughs Wellcome said, well, nobody's going to take rat poison four times a day if they know it's rat poison. We want you to rename it something beneficial. We want you to call it an antiviral drug. It will be an antiviral treatment for so-called AIDS. When they put that drug on the market in 1987, they said, we're going to kill two birds with one stone. We're going to make billions, which they did. People sold their houses, life insurance, everything else to pay for their AZT, thinking they were stretching out their lives. And the other bird they were going to kill was, they said, we're going to get rid of as many gay people as fast as possible because this will be 100% fatal. There'll be no survivors. And there were none. Nobody that took AZT, according to doctor's orders four times a day as they prescribed it, there were no survivors. Everybody died. That drug produces all the symptoms of a person dying of AIDS. In 2010, this book was published, AIDS, Opium, Diamonds, and Empire. She said, we did not have an international epidemic of a virus. We had a deadly virus of international greed. The drug companies saw that they could make billions off people that thought they were dying of AIDS. So they used the bogus HIV test they gave that test to people with the flu, pneumonia, tuberculosis. It turns out that that test doesn't test for HIV because HIV is harmless. The test can classify virtually any sick person you want HIV positive because it reacts to particles in your bloodstream when you're sick from almost anything. This book, Positively False, is the second anniversary edition. The 16th anniversary edition came out of England. Joan Shenton, it's like the 60 Minutes program, it's Channel 4, Meditel. The title of the book is called Positively False, Exposing the Myths Around HIV and AIDS, the 16th anniversary edition. There's like 20 doctors wrote prefaces in here showing what they learned since 1998. There is no worldwide infectious AIDS epidemic. There never was a worldwide infectious AIDS epidemic. There was an infectious epidemic of greed by the billionaires that own and operate the pharmaceutical industry. And they're classifying sick people, telling them they're HIV positive, and then they give them the HIV, the AIDS, supposedly the AIDS medicines, which finish them off. So that's what we've got with billionaire predators running the drug companies. One final thought, for those of you that think that's a myth, look at what Martin Shkreli did. He bought a company, he was an investment broker or something. He bought a pharmaceutical company that was selling a pill for $13 and he raised the price to $7.50. He said, we're sorry you're dying because you can't afford the medicine, but it's not personal, it's just business. That's what you have with a for-profit healthcare system. It's not personal, it's just business. Thank you.
Your turn, Charlie.
All right. Let's see, where we are. We got time, right?
Yeah, we do.
All right. Thank you, Dan, for a nice synopsis there of the healthcare situation in the United States. Are we going to hear from you, Victor? I hope you're working on this. All right, I'll be eclectic as usual here. Little bit of history. This is a topic I'm not terribly well versed on. That doesn't preclude me from speaking up here, though. What happened? Years ago, you got a position and the employer provided health insurance as a condition of employment. Probably also gave you some time off from work in the event of an illness. They didn't want to do that anymore, and even in negotiated agreements of organized labor, you ended up with two-tier systems, where you had one situation for the new hires and one for those indigenous employees, and they got away with this. Also to the fact that you can work your entire life making Tim likes these free market guys, but you work decades working for some guy in order to make him rich, and he does nothing in the event you experience an illness, and certainly he doesn't care what happens to you in old age. What is the result of that? Well, they lucked out, of course. They did nothing. They took care of themselves. As a matter of fact, people aren't aware of this, but there even was legislation, which was fought against by one of the political parties, that if you offered health insurance to the employees of the company, you had to give it to all the employees. But they would take care of themselves in the front office, the CEOs, and everybody else in the installation got nothing. There even were efforts to prohibit this as a labor law. It was opposed, from what I am told, like nothing else that was ever proposed in the history of the United States Congress, that an employer would have to provide the same insurance that they provided the front office and the CEOs to all the employees of the firm. And where does that come? Yes, we have to turn towards, and they said, well, nationalization. The government's the next step. Now, I think the government one time does have perhaps a responsibility to care for those who didn't fall within the workplace things, whatever reason. The government could take care of those
we weren't provided for in the normal capitalist system. But that's, now we have to look towards universal care. And that's it. The other thing is, and is the other problem is the healthcare industry itself. You only hit on one. There are four players on this. There's the professionals, the physicians, and the doctors and the PAs now. And you hit on the hospital networks and the clinics. There's the health insurance industry. And then there's these pharmaceutical companies. And each of them was getting some part of the action. And you gotta take care of all of them. There are many, many people who are very dedicated in the profession. Unfortunately, there are an equal number who felt they were entitled to personal rewards beyond that of everyone else for what they did do. That's what you have to deal with, those four there. Are they certainly a powerful interest group? You better believe it. And they're going to not be very receptive to change that is expensive to them in any way, shape, or form, you know. And the last thing I want to talk about is some of these things I've heard a little bit earlier here tonight, and this, let's clear the air on some of the nonsense here. I used to have an interest in this alternative medicine. We had many, many alternative speakers here. And I've come across it this week, some things about, I'm gonna be done in a minute, dangerous Wi-Fi's, vaccines, now we got this thing right here. Believe you me, this is not for do-wa-dee gibberosity here. Feet on the ground, healthcare illness, these are serious things. Last thing I was gonna say about drugs, everybody goes to the doctor, expects to get a prescription, otherwise they feel cheated. But the thing is, there's an awful lot of, I've heard this week, the Wi-Fi waves, actually is an issue in the presidential campaign.
What about copay?
That the hazardous Wi-Fi, which is nonsense. We've had so many speakers here who were fucking crazy. I'm sorry, they were just nuts. And you over there, you telling me I could cure myself with tapping yourself with your finger?
If you misunderstand,
get out of here.
Okay, you know.
Don't listen. When people have it,
it's Chinese medicine.
There's one thing, another thing, Andy. You're getting into public health stuff. This is transmitted diseases that causes people to die. This is not a conspiracy stuff. This is not Al Jones
stuff. Yeah, but it's supposed to
stuff.
Be prevention.
This
too.
Is serious prevention. Business. Healthcare people die from this stuff.
Okay.
This ain't the same category as you know, Mars landing on the moon or something.
Okay.
We got time.
On.
All right.
Okay, I'm going next time.
There you got it. Yeah, tap yourself.
No.
Tap yourself on your hand.
Chinese medicine.
Hey, wait. That's one fool at a time.
Let me go next.
Tim, what?
Let me go next.
Okay, Tim. Okay, come on down, Tim.
All right.
All right, our esteemed, our videographer, Tim Bolger.
Ridiculous.
What?
You know, all I've heard tonight was basically how bad our health system is, how awful our care is, how greedy all the people are, but maybe you guys haven't noticed something. 100 years ago, average life expectancy was about 50. It's now creeping up to 80, or even in some places, 90. Over the next century, the biggest trend in the world is going to be the aging of the rest of the population. And that is thanks to modern medical science. We've done quite a bit in just the last 30 years alone in the sciences of disease, antibiotics, operations, limb replacement, cancer treatment, to name just a few. And for And a lot of this stuff, frankly, is expensive. A lot of surgeries that extend life and help people go, we're at a point now where we're not getting the easy, the low-hanging fruit with the curing of polio by a vaccine. But I'll tell you who's not getting that low-hanging fruit. It's a lot of our developing countries, where it would be a lot cheaper to bring in a standard of 1950s or 60s healthcare to them, where a lot of it's not. And frankly, a lot of the health of the world rests on, you know, things like clean water, clean air, clean energy. And frankly, the best way for I see to improve public health overall would be generating some form of cheap energy, giving people light, heat, electricity at a very low price, and getting rid of our carbon footprints. This, I'm sorry, you know, I've been rereading my book by Richard Martin called Superfuel and the advantages of thorium and how it can power the world. You know, even though we may have seen a lot of healthcare debacles with some of the costs and everything else, I have to point out that we are living longer. We are a lot healthier than we once were, even maybe 50 years ago. 50 years ago, you go to the hospital, get a diagnosis of cancer, be a death sentence. Now, maybe it's not true, but we have radiation, we have chemo, we have other ways to fight it. You go to the hospital with a heart attack, 50 years ago it'd be a death sentence. Now you've got these life-saving regimes to go in to treat it. Defibrillators, drugs that will help your heart get healthy, restarting, emergency medical services like the paramedics. And again, that's all gonna take money and tax dollars. You know, so what if we spend 10 to 12% of our money in prolonging people's lives? That's an investment that's worth making. And you know, sometimes I may be a diehard capitalist, but there are certain things that government has to do. Protect its citizenry, provide for overall health benefits. And if you remember, even with the construction of the London sewer system, it wasn't, what finally got it over the cliff was the betterment of public health through, you know, treating the sewage and installing a water system that would bring clean water to the masses in the city. This public health argument has been around for years, and governments have spent tons of money on prolonging lives. You know, instead of sitting here debating what we need to do to get a better outcome at hospitals, why don't we really start concentrating on our own health? Simple things: stop smoking, lose weight, get better. And I know I'm probably the chief amongst them who should know better. You know, I'm lucky. I'm a veteran. I get some health care from the VA, and fortunately, it has helped a lot because my employer doesn't provide health insurance. Though it would be a whole different ballgame if he did. I would have probably moved on jobs by now just to get it somewhere else. Bottom line, we are a lot better off than we were under even 50 years ago. It may not be perfect, it may not be the best system in the world, but it is, look over time, producing a vastly better outcome of extending lives, making people live a lot longer, and I'm for it.
All right. Does anybody else wish to give a rebuttal speech? Yes, Victor, come on down.
Are you in favor of people living longer?
Yes. Okay, great.
Okay, you ready?
No, go ahead.
Go ahead.
Maybe your brain
Well, the speaker really had a great presentation. By the way, there is no vaccine against TB.
The thing that they put you under the skin is actually the TTB test, whether you've been exposed to it or not.
Yeah, TTB test, that's right.
Okay. Medicare versus Obamacare. When Medicare first came out, there were a lot of criticisms. I don't know whether there was more criticism against Medicare than against now Obamacare. But the fact that 20 million people that didn't have any insurance now have it. And one little thing, you might have seen this on Nova. You say that, the capitalists will say, okay, people from Canada come here for this and that. Well, there was a 27-year-old or so who had a cervical cancer, and there was no capitalist that would contribute to her medical care, so she had to cross the border. And she went to a clinic and she said, I have a relative here, I was previously living here, and they said, you don't qualify. So she took another trip to another clinic. This is in Canada. And some squad cars were already waiting for her.
Squad guard.
What?
She's American?
She's an American lady.
Yeah. Okay.
But she had no insurance. She has CEA of the service. And she couldn't get any medical care here, so she went over there.
Well, she could live there for
six
months.
But Dan, let him talk.
Okay.
Well, this is rebuttal period, okay? Let him talk. Don't let him interrupt him.
One thing, we it seems like a majority would like to see a universal care, right? How many of you, raise your hand, would like to the universal?
Yeah.
It is the majority. But, every time we think about this, what obstacles are there against universal care? The biggest obstacle is the big money makers, pharma, medical insurance companies. In fact, I think Obama probably had to negotiate just to pass the trinket of Obamacare. He probably had to negotiate of, okay, you abolish pre-existing conditions, you won't oppose us, and we will make sure that everybody it's a mandatory insurance, like driver's insurance. That they had to negotiate like that in order to pass the middle team of Obamacare. Forget about universal care. I think you remember the Clintons?
Mm-hmm.
They were initially pushing universal care. And Hillary at that time even made a card. It was showing the card. It's going to look like Medicare. I don't know whether you read a little piece of literature in that respect. She was very vocal about this universal care. Her mouth was going all over the place. And then crony capitalism kicked in. And so the pharmaceutical company got together with a medical insurance company, and they offered her $850,000. I don't know whether she accepted or not, but you never heard her say one more word about universal. That's crony capitalism. Oh, I hope I'm not on this.
No, you're still got time.
Yeah, 20 seconds.
I'm too shy of camera. And the influence of pharmaceutical companies on medical care, it's a huge one. It's really big. And it's true what they say, and you probably have heard about it, that the student okay? They start with us when we are just students, and they come into the doctor's lounges and will bring us trinkets and all that, and tell us about their drugs. And so, you know where we pick up the famous drugs that I don't think they cure anything, they do treat. I have treated millions of people, but not cured one.
Okay. Wait, this is an announcement. Don, you need a ride, don't you? Yeah, where are you headed to?
Wheeling?
Sheridan Road and, Sunnyside and Sheridan.
Sunnyside and Sheridan?
Yeah, uptown.
Uptown? Anybody?
I can give Don a ride.
All right, thank you very much.
Okay.
Okay, Don, how you doing?
Well, let's just hold on a sec. Now, is there anybody else? Is there anybody else who wants to give a rebuttal speech? Okay, come on, Doug.
Can we have a ride?
All right.
Can we have a ride?
You guys want to give a big rock candy mouth.
Okay.
Thank you.
Well,
he's gone.
I think there's one person at a time speaking. So, anyway, I just finished watching a PBS special. They're doing something on the president, and they covered Lyndon B. Johnson years in the White House. And, you know, you guys have been talking about Medicare today that came out about 1965. And, you know, at the time, Johnson took office in 1964 after Kennedy was assassinated. He had this great vision of a war on poverty. And so he noted at that time there were a lot of people in America that didn't have much going for them in health insurance, and really that was kind of the start of Medicare, you know, that eventually passed in 1965. And, you know, one of the things that bothers me is you guys keep referring to the current health program of Obamacare as if it was really Obama's whole setup. Or actually, going back to kind of Hillary and also President Obama when he presented the healthcare plan with Pelosi, and they actually talked about a single payer, but because of all the resistance that they got from the Republicans about, you know, squeezing out the doctors and pharmaceutical companies and everyone on the take in medicine, they had to reduce it to what we know today, where everyone has to take, they get some benefits a little bit, everyone has to pay. And of course, then there's the people that don't sign up for Obamacare, as you call it, or Affordable Care Act, and they have to pay in some money out of their pockets, especially the younger folks that are healthy and can't see why anybody needs insurance. They're basically in good health and don't have a lot of problems that the older folks have. But one of the things, as a senior citizen myself now, and I wish we really could have, is dental care added on to health benefits. I'm in a Blue Cross Blue Shield plan, and basically meds that I take are paid for from the insurance plan. There's one drug I take, I pay a small fee, it's $6, as a copay on that drug. But one of the things that I've noticed is that there's a lot of citizens with bad teeth. I'm one of them these days, and my girlfriend too. And it would be nice to be able to go to a dental office and have some dental work done, especially tooth extraction and plates and whatever. They have these teeth that they can screw into your gums too these days. And so that's one big thing that I think I would push for going down the line as a senior citizen. You know, they have something for Medicaid, general health insurance, general dental insurance. But you know, as you get older, the teeth wear down, and you know, I was told that, you know, to just extract one tooth, it could cost $150.
And then if you want to be put under, you know, it's another $200 or $300. So for one tooth, it can cost up to $500 to have it extracted, have a tooth put in its place, you know, a false tooth. But so that's my take on insurance for tonight. Thank you.
All right.
Okay, Don, you got anything you want to rebut?
Wait.
Come on,
well, did you want to give a rebuttal speech, Don?
You can buy your own if you can buy dental insurance.
All right. All right. Who else wishes? Anybody else wish to give a rebuttal speech? No?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Okay, come on down.
Give me my bag.
Okay.
This whole healthcare thing is so complex, it's so complicated. There's so much involved with this thing that I think one thing to keep in mind is how do we pay for all this stuff? Who pays for it? When does it get paid for it? Does it get paid for it? Do the kids going to grammar school, are they going to pay for us? We get all of them, pay for our healthcare? I think we have to find a long-term system here. We have to look to the future, get everybody involved, healthy or not healthy. Everybody's got to pay into this thing. I mean, when you're born in a hospital, with some kind of medical care, you're going to die most likely in a hospital. From day one to day zero, you're going to have health care one way or another. In between, some people need more than others. But it's a very complex issue. It's nothing so simple. We got to work. I mean, you already got the hospitals, you got the doctor, you got the school, we got everything here. It's not we're starting from zero. But to go to some uncharted waters with some of these things, what are we getting into? We don't really realize what we're getting into with this thing. We should use our insurance, force our insurance companies somehow to get involved more with this thing, to get people insured, get group plans or something like that, or. I mean, when you go to the government expenses, it's taxpayer money again. That's going to go up and up and up and up and up. We got to find some way to keep the costs down and to get the quality out of it. But you already got the systems in place. We just got to find better ways to work this thing out. I think basically everybody learned how to pay into it. Health account might be a good solution. Some different systems could work different ways. I mean, you might have a catastrophic illness for people that really, something happens in a car accident. I mean, there's no reason that person should go totally bankrupt. The whole family got to go bankrupt. Everybody chips in and helps that person out. But individual got to take care of himself. And there's nothing wrong with spending your own money on your own health care. We spend it for, you know, we make these comparisons, how much we spend compared to other countries. You can't make these comparisons. How much do we spend on alcohol? How much do we spend on tobacco? How much do we spend on football games, concerts? I mean, all these things. I mean, another thing, food, for example, food is inspired by health care. If you don't eat properly, we're going to get sick or we're going to, you know, create some other problems. So should we include food as our health care problem, issue?
Yeah.
It's the basic thing is how do you pay for it? Everybody's going to get chipped in somehow on this thing. And healthy people got to pay. This whole thing, I don't need insurance because I'm healthy. It's not a question. Everybody should chip it. It's like when you buy a house or something, you buy fire insurance. Now, if the house doesn't burn down, you're ahead of the game, man. You sorry the house didn't burn down? You buy automobile insurance. If you never had a big crash on a Kennedy Saturday night or something, are you crying about it? Did you ever cash in on that? No, you didn't worry. Don't worry about it, but you came out ahead. So that's pretty much what I'm saying.
All right. Is there anybody else who wishes to give a rebuttal speech? No? Okay. All right. Well, I'll give a rebuttal speech, Tim. Tim, would you go ahead and start the clock?
Already have.
Okay. All right. Now, first of all, this has actually been a really interesting topic tonight, Dan. I would like to just thank. I'd like to thank Dan for coming in and doing this speech tonight. I think you did a good job, and there was you had a lot of good information here tonight. Now, earlier,
Andy accused me of deliberately trying to stop him from talking during the announcement period because I didn't agree with what he was saying. That's not true. The reason, I actually don't care, really care what Andy talks about. The reason I tried to stop Andy is because that was the announcement period, and what Andy was doing, as somebody else here in the audience pointed out, is he was commenting on the topic tonight. He was offering commentary on the subject of tonight's lecture before the lecture had begun. And that's not appropriate. That means it was a rebuttal speech, a preemptive rebuttal speech, if you will. And the time that there's nothing wrong with commenting on the lecture. That's why we have the College of Complexes. But the time to do that is after the lecture, not before. I just want to say I don't, you know, here at the College of Complexes, we have a right, you know, other than making personal attacks on people present in the room, we have a right to say anything. That's what a freedom of speech forum is. And to quote Voltaire, I disagree with what you say, but I will defend to the death your right to say it. Now, healthcare is a really important issue to a lot of people. And because, let's face it, without healthcare, where are you? So I'd like to, somebody asked me earlier tonight about Brahm, who has been, you know, before I started doing it all the time, Brahm was the treasurer and moderator at the College of Complexes.
So for
those of you who don't already know, I just want to say that Brahm, a few months ago, Brahm Basford, the speaker, moderator at the college.
How's he doing now?
Yeah, if you would please not interrupt me, Ilana, then I could tell people.
I'm sorry. All right, so
Brahm, a few months ago, Brahm fell down and broke his hip and had to go to the hospital. And he's in a rehab center now. They're giving him physical therapy. He's in a wheelchair, but he is gradually recovering. And getting better. However, I met with Brahm a couple of times, and he tells me that he is he's in a bit of trouble. You see. Now, in the old days, let's say, 5 or 6 years ago.
Old days?
Yeah, you'll get into that. It was possible to go to a place like this and have Medicare, and if you were a retired person, you have Medicare and your Social Security check pay for everything, and they would take that as payment, no problems. Well, the place where Brahm is, they don't do that. And so they're saying, part of the problem is this. I understand, I'm not an expert on Medicare, but as I understand it, Medicare, those who are using Medicare are no longer covered 100% like in the old days.
Right.
And that's true? Okay. And now, basically, Medicare will say, we're just going to cover this much, and you got to come up with the money for the rest of it. Is that, am I correct about that?
They're cutting back.
Okay. This gets to my point.
Yeah.
That Medicare, according to Brahm, Medicare is covering only a fraction of his expenses there. The place where he's staying, they're saying, give us our money, you owe us money, and they're saying, if you don't pay us our money, we're throwing you out.
Right.
And so Brahm hasn't recovered yet. He still needs help, but the hospital would rather throw him out. That give him the help that he needs, because they ain't running a charity, y'all. They're running a business. Okay.
That's why we need.
Okay. Can I just look? Everybody else got more. I give everybody else more time, so you got to give me more time too.
That's why we need university.
Go in 6 minutes.
Well, so what I wanted to say, well, not quite. We got more time than that. So now I don't know what to do about this, but this is an immediate problem. And if any of you have any ideas or anything, why don't you come see me? Or you're in touch with Brahm too, aren't you, Gene?
Yeah.
Yes.
Talk to Gene about it. Because this is a serious matter.
Right.
Okay?
Okay?
Rob's. My attorney, Lana. Now, so that's what I wanted to say.
All right, speaker gets the last word.
All right.
Thank you for all the rebuttal. I think we could, Dan, I think what we could do is get a protest. Everybody from the college start protesting and say, you greedy bastards at this rehab place, and have signs that say greedy bastards on it. Just kick it in front, back and forth. Greedy capitalists, and walk back and forth in front of this rehab place until they capitulate, until they say it's okay to stay there. But anyways, besides that, 40 million people with diabetes, with all the commercials for McDonald's and people eating McDonald's all the time, I'm sure there are going to be 100 million people pretty soon with diabetes. So actually, the pharmaceutical companies will do more good work. Yes, saving more people with diabetes. But like somebody said, healthcare includes food, what you eat. So maybe there should be a law against advertising McDonald's. As far as complaining about medicine, I don't think I'm complaining. It's called constructive criticism, I think. I'm constructively criticized. Yes, Charlie. I know you don't believe in that. You believe in working in the system.
All right, go ahead.
With Hillary and like she'll change the system just much at a time. Right. Okay. And the solution to your American girl in Canada, she could live there for 6 months and become a citizen, and then she could get free Medicare. Did you mean to say that the woman was arrested because she was asking for medical care in Canada?
Yeah, she went to a clinic and she asked for medical care. They say, are you a citizen?